Good morning, Adobe. Welcome to online with us this week. We're continuing our series, Keys to a Healthy Church, and I'm just excited about this series. Glad you've been with us online. If you've been with us, if you're in the building later today, we're having our serve. So if you're watching online and you want to come get ready to serve in the building, jump over here with us. We'll start at 11:30. Otherwise, hope you're having a great week. Hope you're enjoying the beautiful weather we've been having. I'm going to jump right in after I pray for you. God, thank you so much for the one who's watching. Lord, today as we talk more about your church and we learn about what the Bible says when it comes to how to be a healthy church, Lord, we just we pray that you would help us embody these things. And we just pray, God, that your will would be done, that you would bless all those who are watching. Lord, be with them. Let them feel your presence in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, hey, last 2 weeks we've been in these healthy keys to a church, and we've talked about learning. The church needs to be learning, it needs to be loving, it needs to be humble, it needs to be a praying church. And so this week we're back for keys to a healthy church, and we've been taking a look at these healthy keys of what a church needs to have. What does Adobe need to have to be like the early church that made it so healthy? And one of those things were, right, we talked about the church being a learning church, a loving church, a humble church, a praying church. And so I'm excited for this week's point. So let's jump in. Acts chapter 2, verse 43 says, "A deep sense of awe came over them all, and the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders, and all the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had." This week, we jump into one of my favorite parts of knowing Jesus. The church should be a supernatural church. Now, in the early church, it was common for the sick to be healed, for the lame to walk, for the deaf to hear, for the mute to speak, for the demonically possessed to be set free, and for broken-spirited people to find hope and healing and mental restoration and emotional restoration. And so all these things took place. And some churches today will actually tell you that those things, the supernatural, are no longer for today. That was for back in the old times. And that's fine for them, and it's not a matter of salvation. But it just makes me so sad that there's Christians walking around today who just deny the supernatural ability of God to still work in our lives. And so I don't know about you, but I want to experience all the incredible things that God has, including the supernatural. And so if he offers things that might not be natural, I'm all for it. Before we start looking at the Bible, can we just agree on one common point? Would you agree with me today that people, Christian or not, are very curious about the supernatural? TV shows, movies, right? I see palm readers and psychics on every street corner. Like, people are very curious when it comes to the supernatural realm. And even people who don't believe in Jesus, who aren't following the Bible, they're interested in the supernatural. This isn't just a church thing. There's more TV shows every year, right? Halloween rolls around, and it's just like, oh my goodness, everybody loves the supernatural. And because we are the created supernatural like beings of God, and we're made in his image, we've been designed with an attraction to the supernatural, a holy curiosity if you know Jesus, but a curiosity if you don't. And so let's see why the church should be supernatural. Acts chapter 5, verse 12 through 16 says, "The apostles were performing many miraculous signs and wonders among the people. All the believers were meeting regularly at the temple in the area known as Solomon's Colonnade, but no one else dared to join them, even though the people had high regard for them. Yet more and more people believed and were brought to the Lord, crowds of both men and women. As a result of the apostles' work, sick people were brought out into the streets on beds and mats so that Peter's shadow might fall across some of them as he went by. Crowds came from the villages around Jerusalem, bringing their sick and those possessed by evil spirits, and they were all healed." Do you not want to experience God that way? When you read that, are you like, eh, that's not for me. I don't care about that. Because I read that and I just think, Lord, how do I get to that point? How does my shadow falling on someone who is unwell heal them? I want to be that kind of person, that kind of follower of Christ. And I wonder, is that the same for you? Like, would you love to see God at work in your life in that way? And I've traveled all over the world. I've been fortunate enough to see a decent amount of miracles. I've been the recipient of 2 supernatural healing miracles, but I'm tired of hearing about miracles happening in other countries, with other people, in other churches. I'm tired of hearing that miracles aren't for today. And I want Adobe to be the kind of place where the supernatural takes place, where God is free to work in this way, where the sick can be healed, where a prophetic word from God can be given to someone who's seeking his will, where we can supernaturally apply God's wisdom to our lives, for people to be supernaturally provided for in their finance and have restoration in relationships, all these great supernatural things. I want that for us as a church. When I was in high school, I've shared, I think, little parts of this story. I made varsity as a freshman at Windsor High School. I started all 4 years. I was pretty incredible. And after my junior year, I was getting some scholarship offers. I made second team all league here in the Sonoma County League. And so all I needed was another great season my senior year, and I would have been set. I would have gone off to college on a soccer scholarship. And that year, I trained earlier than I ever trained. Most years, I'd get up to the day one of Hell Week when we started, and that would be when I would get in shape. This year, I started running in January with friends. Like, we'd be just running miles in the hills, and so I was in great shape. I got into the best shape I've ever been in, and I was ready for the season. And the summer before the season started, just a few weeks before, I was with my brothers in June. We were at the Santa Rosa Mall, and it rained. And my brother, who wasn't driving safely, he hydroplaned at the parking, top of the parking garage at the mall. We ran into the brick barrier at the top. Thank God we didn't go over the edge. and I had some minor whiplash. It messed me up a little tweak in my back. And thank God nothing serious happened to ruin my upcoming season. And then with the same brothers, a week or two later, we went golfing at the Windsor Golf Course. And on the 15th hole, after you finish, there's a big steep hill that comes down to the tee box on hole 16. And we're at the top, and we're just teenagers. And we thought to ourselves, like, hey, there's some grassy mounds that are down there. And wouldn't it be awesome if we take this golf cart down this hill, we floor it, pedal to the metal, we hit those jumps, and we go flying through the air. And so we floor it down the slope, and we hit top speed. You could feel the governor come on and then not stop it because gravity's now pulling us faster than the cart would normally let you go. And we get to the bottom, and we hit the hilly mounds perfectly to set this cart off into space. And in our heads, we figured it would be just like the movies when fast cars go off of jumps. It'd be slow motion through the air, and then it would just be incredible, right? And we'd be flying through the air, we'd be like high-fiving each other, be like, oh, this is incredible. Like, and as we're in the mid like air, flying through the air, this is how we picture it. And apparently all the weight on a golf cart is in the front half, and the people are there, the battery and all that stuff is in there. And so we hit the air, and then we immediately nosedive and crash in to the ground. We break the golf cart, and I was in the middle of my two brothers. They each had a handle, and I was thrown from the cart. I imagine it was a pretty violent scene if videos on cameras existed back in those days. And my two brothers, who had a handle to hold on to, they came over laughing and shouting, like, oh my gosh, that was awesome. You got thrown from the golf cart. And then when they realized I couldn't move, I laid there motionless. I couldn't feel anything, and I didn't know what to think. And I don't know how much time passed, if it was 30 seconds or 30 minutes, but time passed and it felt like forever. And eventually I could feel my body again. But when feeling came back, it felt like I was on fire. Eventually, I hobbled off the course, went home to recover. A few weeks later, on day one of our conditioning camp, I did a stretch. We were jumping and running and stretching at the same time, and something in my body popped. I crumpled to the ground. I went to the doctor. I had torn ligaments, torn muscles, and the joints on my spine were all messed up, and I was in physical therapy 3 days a week for months, and I missed every game of my senior year. The pain was always there. I couldn't sleep. I couldn't sit without discomfort. It was bad, and I figured I'd have pain the rest of my life. I was 17 years old. Fast forward a year, I'd given my life to Jesus. 9 months after that, I was at a conference, and we were at the service, and they did a call to come down to be prayed for, and I went down, and in an instant, God healed my back. I don't know how to explain it to other people. I just know there's instances in the Bible where Jesus laid hands on people, and they were healed immediately, and that is what I experienced, and I've never had pain in my back since then. That injury was wiped away, and Jesus is not a superhero. He doesn't have a superpower. He has all the power. Matthew chapter 28 verse 18 says, Jesus came and told his disciples, I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. And Adobe needs to be the kind of church where God can move in the supernatural, where if you're sick, if you're in pain, if you're hurting, if you need healing, you can come and you can be prayed for, and God moves supernaturally. And in fact, if you're watching right now, I just want to pray for you at home. And so if you're watching and you're sick, you have some kind of ailment, you have COVID, you have a broken bone, you have a torn ligament, you have some joint problem, you have whatever it is, arthritis, I just want to pray for you. God, I pray for supernatural healing to go forth from this screen. God, you're not limited by the medium of which we pray. And so God, I pray right now for the one who is in need of healing supernaturally, that you would touch them. God, that you would remove that sickness, that you would bring wholeness, that you would bring wellness, that you would bring healing in Jesus' name. We pray that you would bring body parts into proper alignment, that joint pain would be released, that pressure in our bodies would dissipate. God, I pray for ongoing headaches that have been bothering people. God, that you would eliminate that right now in the name of Jesus. God, we trust you for healing. We pray that you would do it. In your name we pray, amen. I want to end this point about the church and Christians needing the supernatural. Now, you're going to get a different demonstration than people in live church, but here's what I want you to understand. Like, think of it in terms of you're doing a project construction, and you have some screws, and you have to put these things into some wood. And here's the thing, right? If you had the choice, and you had this screwdriver, and you had to drive in hundreds of screws into these studs for some kind of project, would you choose to use a screwdriver where you're hand screwing every single thing of the project? Or would you want to use a drill? Would you want to use some kind of impact driver that all it takes is a push of a button, and it powers beyond your normal ability to drive these things home? Even the most skilled craftsman could use a little extra power. Can I tell you, you could be the best at prayer. You might read your Bible the most. You could share the great news about Jesus everywhere you go. And even if you are the best, being connected to God's supernatural power will make your life more powerful. If you're using the drill, if you're connected to power sources, things will just happen that you couldn't do on your own in the time that you couldn't manufacture on your own. The church needs to be supernatural. Next is in Acts chapter 2, our main verses. Verse 43, it says, a deep sense of awe came over them all, and the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders. The next verse, 44, says, all the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had. The church being a supernatural place is fun. It's just a fun part of following Jesus. The next thing that the church needs to be is crucial for the success and health of a good church, right? The key to a healthy church is that the church should be unified. Is everyone here familiar with Puzz 3D? You remember Puzz 3Ds? They were real hot in the 90s. I remember when they came out as a kid, and I was not much of a puzzle doer, but immediately I saw Puzz 3D for buildings, and I love architecture. And so, like, you could build Big Ben in a puzzle, and it's like a Lego, but a puzzle. I saw them for 3D Star Wars spaceships, right? You can build the Millennium Falcon in puzzle form. And we actually got that one year as a gift. And so, of course, we bought several Puzz 3Ds thinking, how amazing are these going to be to do? And we tried like crazy to get these things put together. And we pieced a few pieces together. But it never came together quite right. And I don't remember us ever finishing a Puzz 3D. I do remember an unopened Puzz 3D box still in the plastic 30 years later, 20 years later, that was just in the closet that no one ever opened. The church being unified is like those god-awful Puzz 3Ds. They're incredible to look at when they're all complete and everything is as it is designed to be. The finished product is amazing. Getting there, kind of a nightmare. Unity is the same way. Unity is amazing. And when you see it, you just are in awe. You're like, wow, that's incredible. But getting to be in unity is a real hassle because you don't believe like everyone believes. You don't feel like everyone feels. And you have different opinions from the same amazing people who come to Adobe Church. And so the church is often like an unfinished puzzle. Every piece is on its own, doing its own thing, scattered out, and doesn't want to be connected to the whole. A puzzle piece by itself is nothing special. An individual in the church, like, God loves you, you're incredible, but there's nothing special about a single person doing their own thing within the church. And a puzzle piece by itself doesn't display what it should. It isn't as beautiful. It's not designed to be alone. And in fact, it's specifically designed or created to fit perfectly into the right spot, interlocking with other pieces. And a puzzle piece that isolates itself or tries to insert itself into the wrong place ruins the entire design. A single missing piece keeps the entire puzzle from reaching its potential. And when all the pieces are put together the way they're supposed to be, the way that they're designed, then you're able to see the big picture. And when every piece is connected and put in the right place, you can see the purpose that it was created for. And now, I hate Puzz 3D because I could never get all the pieces where I wanted them to go. But man, I love putting the pieces together in a church. I think getting you where God designed you to be and connecting you with the people that you're designed to be with, that's my favorite part. And putting the pieces of this church together as we go through the next 3, 5, 10 years together, those are the exciting things. That's what I'm all about. And churches can get frustrating too because we all come from various backgrounds. We see things different. We all have an idea of how the puzzle should be put together. And here's how we need to believe that unity works when it comes to Adobe. Here's what it should look like. I shared this in the intro week, but if you picture a bus, right, and everybody who attends Adobe, they get on the bus. You're on the Adobe bus. And if you're here, you stay here. Right now, you're a bus rider, right? You're riding the Adobe bus, and we're going to make some stops along the way, and people are going to get off the bus. Some people might say, you know what, Adobe's not for me anymore. You know what, Pastor Sean's not for me. And they're going to get off the bus. And at the same time, we're going to make stops and people are going to get onto the bus. And we're going to have people getting in and out of the bus as we go through, like, we're building this church and being people who can reach this community. And now everyone's going to be on or off the bus, but those who are on the bus, you're on the Adobe bus. And it's not just enough to get everybody on the bus and have the bus going in the same direction. Some people won't like their neighbor. Some people won't like their seat. Some people won't like the position on the bus where they are sitting. And unity in the church is when we're all on the bus, going the same direction, at the same pace, to the same destination, and everybody is seated in the right chair next to the person they're supposed to be seated next to. When we're all where we're supposed to be, that's what unity looks like. And that is the best kind of bus ride you could hope for. When you're serving in the area of church, you're supposed to be serving in. You're fulfilling what God has called you to do, right? That's why we're having Adobe serve after our live service this week on Sunday. It's because you have a purpose in this church. You say, well, I'm just watching online. You have a purpose in this church. Reach out to me. Let's find some ways that if you're just digital right now that you can still get involved and serve, because we got a satellite that's pumping this screen into the bus and you're on the bus with us. And so let's find out a way that you can be engaged in serving. We don't opt out, right? Because we're not in person at the church. You're still here with us. And so I want to encourage you. There's a place for you to serve. There's a place for everybody. And we, the church, need you. Nobody should be doing nothing. Everyone should be doing something. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 says, so Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and teachers to equip his people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the same knowledge of the Son and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Can I tell you, COVID has created a great bus shakeup. All these churches have crashed their buses together. People have been thrown from the bus, and they're just getting into new buses right now. Every church who I know who's experiencing amazing growth in the midst of COVID are experiencing that growth because people are changing buses. They're not getting people who haven't been on the bus into the bus. People are just hopping around, and there's not the same commitment level, and people are getting on and off. And for those of you who stay on the bus, we just got to find the right seat for you. And we got to get you in the right place. And as we do that, unity will happen. But right now, the bus is more like a third grade field trip. Someone's got to get off the bus to puke. Someone's got to run to the bathroom. Kids are trading seats, moving around. It's just chaos. There's paper airplanes flying all over. The bus driver's like yelling at everyone like, hey, don't make me come back there. There's not enough volunteers to corral all the kids on the bus, right? It's just a little bit of mayhem in the church world right now because of this pandemic issue. And it's hectic now. And after church, you know, today we're going to have Adobe serve. We're starting to get people plugged in to being able to volunteer and to serve again. And I think that generates some momentum and gets some excitement about being engaged and being part of the church. And same thing for you digitally, like reach out to me. There's a spot for you that you can engage in. And if you feel like Adobe is your bus, or this bus is the plan that you have to ride on for now, we're going to ask you to engage and to say like, hey, I want to be involved. Where can that be, right? If you're a computer person who can run video stuff, right? That might be helpful. Like, hey, we could make this video feed better. Let us know if you can do that. If you're a musician or singer, come back into the building. We need more members on the team. If you love doing administration or landscaping or building or whatever it is, let us know. If you're gifted with hospitality or teaching, we want to know that. If you're the friendliest person on the planet, we want you greeting people. Let us know. If you like data entry, we have tons of it. Let us know. If I didn't mention what you're awesome at, let me know it so we can figure out where that fits into the puzzle here at Adobe so that we can be stronger and unified. This isn't you making a commitment. I'm not making you sign up for anything. I just want to know. Just simply start a dialogue with you, right? And if you have no clue what you want to do, I would rather have you do something, and if it's not the right fit, then we'll change your seat rather than you hesitate to like, I don't know if I should be on the bus or not. Let's get on this bus together and go for a ride. The church, the Big C church, right? This church, we need to be unified. All the parts in the right place make the church exactly what it's supposed to be. It's people. It's not this building. It's not the screen that you're watching on. It's not the name of this simple, like singular church, right? It's the people of God getting into the right place, going where God wants them to go. Unity for unity's sake's not enough, right? The Tower of Babel in the Old Testament, they were unified in opposition to God. So right, you don't just want to be unified. We want to be unified with purpose, behind vision and direction. And one person not in unity can disrupt all the process. Now, this doesn't mean you like everyone. It doesn't even mean you have to like me. You can still be at this church, serve at this church, love this church, and not like me. I'm okay with that. Now, I hope that you like me or that you will grow to like me, but you don't have to. Like, that's not part of being part of a church. And unity simply means we understand that God has called us together to accomplish his purposes through this church. Let's do that. I'm going to pray for you, and then we're going to let you go. God, I thank you so much for the one who's watching. Lord, I pray that we would be a supernatural church that your Spirit would move in our lives, that we would be aware of your presence at work. God, it takes the supernatural for a church to be unified. God, I pray that we would walk in forgiveness, we wouldn't hold on to grudges, that we wouldn't hold on to hate for enemies. God, that we would love all people. Lord, I pray for Adobe that it would be a unified church. Pray for the people who are watching, God, that we would grow in our unity. We'd grow closer to you with one another. God, we're going to trust you for that result. Only you can bring unity. So God, help us get our hearts right. Prepare us for where we need to be so that we can do what we need to do. So we can be the church that you created us to be part of. Lord, I pray your blessing on everyone in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Hey, I want to give you a quick opportunity. We've changed over our giving platform. And so if you give digitally, I want to give you just a few minutes of information so you can change that over. If you go to the website adobecc.org, click on the Give tab at the bottom of the page. There's a button. It will take you to the new giving platform. If you have set up a reoccurring gift in the old platform, go ahead, set that up in the new one. Shoot me an email. I'll just delete it out of the old one for you. And so I can do that. I've done about half of them for people already. So if you would change that over, it would help us out a ton. You can also text your dollar amount to the number 84321. Search Adobe Christian Church and it will connect you and your text giving to the church here. And then also you can go online. You can download on your phone in the app centers, the Church Center app. It's called the Church Center app. And it will also connect you. So you'll be able to see up to date for your giving records. Eventually small group signups will be done through there and a few other things too. So go ahead, check that stuff out. If you have any questions, shoot me an email, sean@adobecc.org. I would love to just walk you through that if you need help with anything. It's taken the average person like 1 minute to get signed up. So it's been super easy. If you're having trouble, reach out, let me know. I'd love to help you with that as well. Another FAQ question, a lot of people are asking, well, hey, oh, the fees are so high. No, the fees are lower than what we were paying before. You just see what they are now. And so you have the option sometimes to cover that, or if you do an ACH bank transfer as your way to give, it's only 25 cents and it eliminates almost the entirety of the fees that we have. So I would encourage you to take a look at that, reach out if you have any questions. Otherwise, God bless you. Thanks for being with us. We're having Adobe Serve live right now on Sunday. If you're in the area, join us at 11:30. If you're watching this after the fact, you missed a great one. I assume it was awesome. And then also mark your calendar. March 6th, we'll be here in the building for our annual business meeting. God bless you. Have a great week.